y a Miles especialmente por haberme traído aquí. El título, como pueden comprobar y como han comentado otros compañeros esta mañana, es de una amplitud y de una ambición que evidentemente no voy a colmar. Y además, al no haber fijado las fechas, he despistado al organizador porque mi hueco, y además perfecto, habría sido entre María Antonieta y Manuel, porque yo acabo con Propaganda Fide y empiezo después de Sixto Quinto. Pero, así que de una forma no del todo ordenada, vamos a dejar todo el siglo XVI y mitad del XVII muy bien cerrado, yo creo. Y ahora paso al inglés, al que me comprometí también de forma muy, muy alegre en mi título. This image we see here, that is an epiphany, the adoration of the Magi, could work as a metaphor of what I tried to explain today, that is how the Pope received the ambassadors from outside Europe, and this is like the Pope being Jesus, receiving the three parts of the world, Asia, Africa, and Europe. America did not exist in a biblical sense. And the global scope of Catholicism and this ecumenic view, according to what, since 1450, more or less, when also the image of Balthasar as a black king begins to be imposed, because it didn't exist before, we see that the Papal Rome, after the Western Schism, renewed such ecumenical scope, the conversion aims, and a generous interpretation of the Jus Gentium, according to which peaceful missions have to be always accepted, albeit being sent by enemies or pagans. And the experience of the papacy in this realm is very wide. This is the Church of Santo Stefano degli Abissini. And since 1479, there is a national church of the Ethiopians, of the Abyssians, in Rome. So I want to focus precisely in that local aspect, not to see the globalization in the huge world, but how it impacted in the city of Rome or in the reception of embassies in Rome. Actually, this poor and humble presentation is the first presentation I make of the new project I intend to develop in the next 2 or 20 years. That is, I think I try to grasp one of the main challenges and most vibrant discussions in early modern history. This is building a more nuanced narrative of globalization, transcending the dual framework of Eurocentrism or postcolonialism. And for that, I changed the predominant departing point, and instead of studying world connections from the European expansion, I intend to analyze the mission sent to Rome, especially via Spain, by extra-European polities, and today between 1580 and 1622. Among these polities, in the sense of non-Latin Christendom, are included subjects of the Ottoman Empire from Lebanon, Georgia or Maghreb, Persians, Congolese or Japanese. By focusing in envoys, in the broadest sense possible, we surpass the mediated vision of missionaries and conquerors, while these foreign individuals negotiated their acknowledgement as legitimate political agents. I want to see these Japanese, Congolese, or Persians not as an exotic figure with a turban, but as political actors able to negotiate and to intermediate in the political culture. When recognized as elite actors, their cases tested the flexibility of court culture and the degree of adaptation of diplomacy in which the normative order was still under construction. The selected chronology begins with incorporation of the Portuguese Empire to the Spanish monarchy in 1580, thus creating the first global empire of history, and softening the previous Portuguese reluctance to accept extra-European envoys. And the end is marked by the foundation of the Propaganda Fide Congregation in 1622, that, as Manuel Ribeiro has mentioned before, changed the precarious balances between the monarchy and the papacy for evangelization beyond Europe. Since then, the ability of the Spanish monarchy to challenge, limit, and boycott Roman missions beyond Europe dramatically diminished. During this time lapse, Rome consolidated its role as a global center of diplomacy, information gathering, and production of knowledge, as Maria Antonietta has brilliantly exposed before. The papal courts benefited from the dense networks developed by the skillful system of nunciatures, the Jesuits, and other missionary orders. But against the usual bilateralism of diplomatic studies, my project advocates for a multilateral approach through the systematic collection and analysis of every available case of study in Rome. The dimension to compare these Roman pretensions of universalism is the Spanish court, which shifted between complementary collaborator and discrete competitor. The global scope of counter-reformation Catholicism coexisted with the worldwide ambitions of the contemporary Spanish monarchy as the first global empire. The clashes between Spain and the papacy have been emphasized by recent literature on the political arena, but there is still a huge open field about their tensions for global representation and their divergent models of integrations. Authors have tended to specialize either in the Spanish or papal side and to overshadow the simultaneous endeavors of the other court. However, many of these missions stayed in Madrid before traveling to Rome, and normally combining the mediation of Catholic clergy and the implication of Iberian networks and territorial interests in the Indian, Pacific, and Atlantic oceans. Recent literature has paid a renewed attention to these exotic missions, but primarily focusing on the creation of mutual images and perceptions and the circulation of cultural devices. However, my interest is the clash between the Spanish monarchy and the papacy to take benefit of these global contacts and the limits of competition and cooperation between both powers. I focus especially in the context around 1600, marked first by the war against the Turks in Hungary, that led the opening of contacts with other Asian powers, and this new Iberian monarchy, because the Habsburgs did not refuse to admit African and Asian embassies as the Portuguese did before, and both factors issued an unprecedented variety of missions received in Europe, in Madrid and Rome especially. The angle I am interested in is the papal ability to introduce new members to the, in the terms of Belli, the European Society of Princes, at times agreeing, at times rivaling with the House of Austria, depending on the circumstances. A case of concord, of good correspondence between Madrid and Rome, is the case of Transylvania. This is the Prince Sigmund Báthory, who reigned between 1588 and 1602, and he was accepted in the Catholic elite thanks to his switch of band from being an Ottoman vassal to a crusader hero that rebelled against the Sultan and joined the emperor in the war against the Turks in Hungary. And we see in the case of Báthory how the emperor, the king of Spain, and the pope collaborated to give him the devices and the honor required to be accepted in this society of princes. The Emperor Rudolf II in 1595 appointed him as Reichsfürst, Prince of the Empire, and considered him the hand of his niece, Christiana of Austria, as his wife. The Pope, Clement VIII, sent a permanent nuncio to his court of Alba Iulia, also in 1595, Alfonso Visconti. And next year, he envoyed another agent, Ludovico Anguissola, with the blessed sword that was probably the most prestigious gift that the Pope could make to a Catholic prince. And Philip II of Spain, in 1596, awarded the Golden Fleece to the Prince of Transylvania. So with these elements, he could be seen as a new member of this Catholic Society of Princes. The crucial role in these negotiations depends on his almost unique ambassador that was not a very exotic individual, but a Jesuit from Alcalá de Henares, the father Alfonso Carrillo, who traveled to Prague, to Rome, and to Madrid. So it's not a bilateral diplomacy. It's always traveling from one court to other. And the mission makes sense and has success because it's an accumulation of negotiation and successes. And Alfonso Carrillo offered a high political capital both to the Pope and to the King of Spain because he gave the opportunity to support an exotic prince with a virtuous mission that was fighting against the Turks and being a Jesuit and a Castilian. The Nuncio Camillo Caetani in Madrid in 1596 acknowledges the wise idea of sending Carrillo to Madrid because, quote, in Madrid, hanno piacere che si sia mandata persona espressa a far ricorso a sua maestà et implorare il suo aiuto, giudicando che ciò appartenga molto alla sua reputazione. È stato molto accertato che venisse un gesuita per la molta autorità che tengono con i ministri e che fosse naturale di questi regni. This case of Transylvania is not a unique one because in the case of the Japanese, Persian or Congolese missions are always at least dual missions sent to the Spanish monarchy and to the papacy. We have mentioned today several times this first Japanese mission, the Tensho mission of 1584-85, and it's difficult to define as diplomacy in the most classical sense because it was a very peculiar voyage between an exotic grand tour, Jesuit messengers, and proper noble ambassadors. They were 12, 13 years old. They were Japanese converted to Catholicism, and it was like a Rolling Stone tours across Europe to show this new Catholic nation. And Father Balignano, that was the entrepreneur, also wanted that these Japanese returning back to Japan could demonstrate that Europe was rich and splendorous and that the Jesuits going to Japan were not escaping from poverty and misery, but their missionary aim was different. The interesting point is that they arrived to Lisbon and they were accepted in Madrid. And since the clue of Madrid was opened, they traveled to Italy, they arrived to Rome. And the Portuguese networks that, of course, worked from Lisbon, permit them to be received in the European courts. The Braganzas, the Mouras were the families that helped them to be accepted in the rest of the court. The Persian missions, there were between four and six in the two first decades of the 17th century, have been the most known ones. The first one, the Hussein Ali Beg and Anthony Shirley in 1601, is interesting because they arrived from Persia to Europe through Russia. So they went first to Prague, then to Rome, and then to Madrid. It's the opposite route. And since in Prague, Rudolf II accepted them as proper and noble ambassadors, in Rome and in Madrid, they were almost forced to also acknowledge them and not break the reception and the style marked by the emperor. The margin of ceremonial adaptation for a dual mission of a Christian and a Muslim ambassadors who claimed to be the only authentic was very thorny because Hussein Ali Beg was the real official ambassador and Anthony Shirley was an adventurer that was claiming to be the translator and at the end stole all the presents and the gifts sent by the Persians. And in Rome, they faced the problem of what to do with a Persian, an English, a Christian, and a Muslim who claimed to be the only and one ambassador. So A difference to the Madrid court, Rome had enough ceremonial experience to deal with this delicate issue. And for example, they received both ambassadors in different moments. Prelates were not sent to receive the Persian one, and the Persian one in the cavalcade was not put in the center but to the right, because he was convinced that the European Jews was that the position of honor was the right one and not the center, because he was a Muslim and they were measuring every step, not to over react with him. They were given separated audiences, and for example, when Ulibert was received in a public reception in the Quirinale, he spoke to the Pope on his knees, but the papal shoe that had a cross was covered by a cloth, not to offend this Persian ambassador. And this quarrel between the English and Persian ambassadors in Rome gives also an example of how to deal with diplomatic conflict, and not, again, in a bilateral sense, because the Spanish diplomacy in Rome cooperated, knowing that the next step of this mission was not Madrid, Valladolid, in that year. And the ambassador Cesa was in accordance with the papal authorities to pay Anthony Shirley to go out of the mission, not disturbing Hussein Ali Beg in his trip. And also, both the papal and Spanish authorities prevented the French diplomacy to interact with this mission, and the project of Cardinal Dossat that these persons also could go to Paris, and we see this diplomatic cooperation between different agents. So when Hussein Ali Beg arrived to Valladolid, Philip III had very small room for maneuver, because he only analyzed the carefully detailed reports on the Persian receptions in Prague and Rome, and adapted it to the Spanish Jews. And I appreciate here a big contrast between the contemporary pontifical ceremonial records by Giovanni Paolo Mucante, very detailed, and the lack of ceremonial memory in Spain that has to resort to the very immediate precedents to know how to react to these cases. As these Persian missions were repeated every 2-3 years, we see that the circulation finally is somehow established. And in the mission of 1611 of Tengiz Beg and Robert Shirley, the brother of this mischievous Anthony Shirley, they went through the route Lisbon, Madrid, Rome. But in Madrid there was a Persian convert from the first mission, Juan de Persia, that acted as translator in Rome, so the Persian network established in Europe was in this moment yet circulating and helping the new ambassadors between Madrid and Rome. Probably is more rich in details the Keisho mission, the second Japanese mission to Europe, and actually the first one with a real ambassador, that is this Hasekura Susenaga, in 1614-15. This is the portrait he was made in Rome with a traditional kimono. And his actual clothes in Europe, because he was clothed as a Portuguese gentleman. But in Rome, they preferred to use these fancy clothes to show the exotic character of this parvenu agent. The Council of Indies in Spain analyzed the quality of this mission, and parallel, the Daimyo Date Masamune, the king of Boksu, who was the sender of this ambassador. And as he was a vassal of the Japanese shogun, The parallel they found for the European traditions was like that the Shogun was the emperor and he was a small prince of Italy. So he was treated in Madrid as an agent of Mantua or Parma, as the style. And it shows that the court of Madrid had a very limited freedom for ranking and deciding on the treatment given to these agents, because the choices were not only conditioned by the precedence of other princes, but also by the Spanish intermediate authority is in other centers of power. Whether ambassadors, viceroys, or corregidores did not filter or stop these individuals, they prefigured the receptions and obliged the royal court to accept them with the due solemnity before contradicting its officials. If they are received in Lisbon as ambassadors, they stick to this model, and in Madrid they are also received as ambassadors. The Council of Indies criticized the lack of zeal of the Portuguese authorities in this Japanese case, because the negotiation they were carrying could be better conducted without entertaining a delicate embassy at the court. However, well, it was not in Lisbon, but in Seville. However, once the envoys were in Madrid, the Council of State regained the initiative and could modulate the treatment made to these agents. For example, after the Japanese Hasekura completed his mission in Madrid and traveled to Rome, King Philip III did not allow him to return to Madrid, and, informed by a simple peon, he was ordered to wait in Seville until the American fleet would be ready to return to American Japan. And the same happened in Rome, where the Spanish ambassador Castro received a clear information on the clueless Hasekura mission and shared this information with papal diplomacy, so that Hasekura received the same dilatory answer as he had in Madrid. The final case I want to show and to pay attention is the Kingdom of Congo. This is the city of Banza Congo or São Salvador de Congo. And the kings of Congo were Christians due to the Portuguese mediation since 1491. The Portuguese crown took Congo as a vassal kingdom and a part of the royal patroado to Congolese dismay that claimed these kings to be independent Catholic king. But the Abish dynasty prevented Congolese kings to communicate directly with the Pope, albeit being independent and allied Catholic kings and sharing a Portuguese courtier culture. Maria Antonieta Vicelia has mentioned the famous Tristão da Cunha mission to Rome in 1514. By that moment, in Lisbon, there was the first Congolese ambassador, Pedro de Sousa, that was a Portuguese. And he was held in Lisbon and not allowed to go to Rome with the embassy of Tristão da Cunha, as happened in the next embassies that arrived in Lisbon. That is the case of Manuel, a brother-in-law of the King of Congo, Afonso I, in 1540, who wrote to João III of Portugal, asking for an armored caravel to take him to Rome to offer obedience to the Pope. The King of Portugal never answered to this petition. In 1546, Diogo Gomes, the ambassador of the new king of Congo, Diogo I, also anxiously showed papal recognition of his claim to the throne, but he did not pass further than Lisbon. And in 1588, in a moment in which Philip II was the king of Portugal, Duarte López arrived to Lisbon with credentials for the Pope and in a very candid way, this credential wrote that the king wanted to escape from the Portuguese Padroado and to develop an autonomous Catholicism under direct rule of the papacy. And due to the pressure of Philip II, Sixtus V did not accept his credentials, and although Duarte arrived to Rome, he was not received by the Pope. Having seen this case, the next mission in 1594, that of Antonio Vieira, who was a relative of the King Álvaro II of Congo, he was sent to Lisbon, and to Philip II and Archduke Cardinal Albert of Austria, Viceroy of Portugal, to not to accept being him sent to Rome and repeat this problem. He was put in Lisbon, and it was demonstrated that from Lisbon, without moving from the city, he could develop his mission with success. His credentials were for creating an independent Congo diocese, separated from the Portuguese diocese of Santo Tomé, and the papal collector Biondi and Mesa da Consciência supported his claim. And this bishop was created in the next year in Rome, so he could return to Congo, showing that going to Lisbon was enough for these missions. But Pope Clement VIII and Collector Biondi invited him to send an ambassador to the King of Congo, quote, as do all Christian kings. Alvaro II accepted this plan, but Vieira died during the preparations. And while the papacy was expecting a new Congolese embassy and also the Spanish monarchy, in 1604 arrived Diogo Gonçalves Manuel, that resulted to be a phony ambassador, a Portuguese priest who at least was active in Brazil, who was suspended from his clerical activities and exiled, but he appeared in Lisbon and in Valladolid claiming to be the ambassador of Congo, and the Council of Indias in Lisbon at the end demonstrated that he was an impostor and a fake individual, and took benefit of this moment to attempting to ban new Congo's embassies to Spain, because they were fearing this easiness and facilities that Philip III was giving to these individuals that was challenging the Portuguese Padroado throughout Spain. And royal letters from the Consejo da India were sent to Valladolid to be seen by the king, banning these new missions, but Philip III refused to sign the letters, quote, por não ser conveniente impedirse aos reis enviarem seus embaixadores antes de ter entendido que de sua residência em minha corte resulta conservar-se melhor a amizade e boa correspondência com eles. And we see this difference of criterion, and this Diogo Gonçalves escaped from Lisbon. He arrived to Rome, and he asked for papal aid because he claimed to have been ransacked during his journey. Finally, he was fired, but it's also this curious case. And the final ambassador who at the end arrived to Rome was Antonio Manuel Nebunda. When he arrived to Lisbon, the Viceroy asked for instructions to the king, because now asho exemplos do que nisto se costuma, because he was the real first ambassador, and the attitude in Lisbon and in Madrid was could be defined as passive resistance, because they did not want him to go to Rome, but they could not oppose directly to this. Nebunda arrived with 25 attendants and a lot of currency, but Congolese currency that has this simbu, that are shells, that has no value in Lisbon and in Madrid. So he spent 1 year and a half in Madrid in the convent of the Mercedaries, waiting for permission or for money to go to Rome. At the end, when Nuncio Mellini returned, he took Nebunda with him. It's interesting how he learned the court culture in Madrid, because only after he pleaded directly to the Duke of Lerma to his petition to be listened, after 1 week, the Council of Portugal discussed his credentials. And he arrived to Rome in 2 January 1608, and after 4 days he died. He was very ill, And after 1.5 years expecting for him, he died. And here we have his tomb in Santa Maria Maggiore. It's important to notice that Ambassador Aitona and the Portuguese agent in Rome, José de Melo, tried to oppose Paul V's pretension of accepting him as an ambassador, because they claimed that the Kingdom of Congo was not an independent kingdom, but a vassal of the Crown of Portugal. Paul V at the end did not have to do anything because he died. And this agent was not a lost Congolese because he found very powerful allies in the Discalced Carmelites that intended to develop the evangelization of Congo with their friars. So the network of Castilian Carmelites mobilized to help him, and they found the opposition of Dominicans, Augustines, and the authorities of Portugal. Always in these cases, there are a meddling of religious orders, national or realm interests, and so on. I'll try to finish. It's interesting to see the question of cultural diplomacy, because according to the King Alvaro II of Congo, Philip III was his brother or his friend, and he pretended, Alvaro, to be a papal vassal and to receive a very generous royal patronage, like a local version of the Padroado. And he was very precisely informed of how a privileged royal chapel worked, and he wanted to have the same royal chapel that the kings of Portugal had in Lisbon for him, and to have also a cardinal protector, and who was Cardinal Sfondrati in the first moment. And in São Salvador, he had a proper royal cancellery with Portuguese officials, fluent in official Italian, and very keen in European diplomatic practices, because Nebunda was undoubtedly received as ambassador because he came with instructions, credentials, memorials, and everything was signed and sealed, in a very sharp contrast with the phony ambassador Gonsalves. The interest of these images is that Albert Nebunda spent only 4 days of his life in Rome. There are lots of remains of his stay. We have this tomb, this medal in the Vatican Sala Paolina. We have this fresco by Giovan Battista Ricci, in which Paul V gives the benediction to a bedridden Nebunda when he was about to die. On these engravings, in which Albert he came also in a Portuguese court fashion. He is always represented with this enkutu, that is the traditional Congolese fashion, and a quiver, that is very strange. And this makes sense in the context of the Venetian interdict. We are in 1608, and while the Congo exemplary submits to the Pope, the Italians are disobeying the Pope. And we have this also, this version of Nebunda in a very famous space, that is the Sala Regia in Quirinale Palace, in which we have the representations of most of these agents sent in the time of Paul V. The Japanese, we have Hasekura, the Persians, the Chaldeans. Here is the distributions of the different exotic missions received during Paul V's papacy. And the last question I make is, why, if Nebunda spent 1.5 years in Spain and Portugal, there's no notice of him, neither Cabrera de Córdoba in his relation of the court mentions his presence. He developed to be a place of memory in Rome. And I think that we find here a question of representation of majesty and dominance that is very dissimilar between the papal and the Spanish case. We have precedents of the nations of the world obeying to the Pope, but first to the Emperor. This is the Gospel of Otto III, around the year 1000, and the emperor receives gifts by the personification of the four nations of his empire, Italy, Gallia, Germany, and Slavia, in San Zeno Maggiore a Verona, in 1230, more or less. Frederick II receives the homage of 29 representatives of the world's peoples. And in the papal case, in the 15th century, we have these Filaretes engravings that are the San Pedro's Basilica doors, in which Pope Eugenius IV consigning the decrees of union to Abbot Anthony, the head of the Coptic delegation at the Council of Florence. We have the Coptic and Ethiopian delegations being received by the Pope. In Santo Spirito in Sassia, also the merits of Pope Sixt the Fourth is to receive the Eastern rulers and sovereigns. Here you have to imagine that Sisto IV ricevi sovrano Andrea Paleologo, Leonardo Tocco e Sofia, sposa di Ivan III, re di Moscoviti. And while we have this culture of representation of foreign ambassadors as or nations of the world as a mark of honor by the high Middle Age emperors and popes, and also when Louis XIV made the Scaldes ambassadors in Versailles Palace, the Lebrun frescoes were the fourth part of the world, the peoples of the world, being invited to the scene. In the Spanish tradition, we are not going to find something like that. Manuel Rivero has spoke very, very sharply on the significance of the Salón de Reinos, and we have a very different lecture in Spain. There is no formal recognition of globalism, but of dynastic legitimism of kingdoms. All of them are Europeans, excepting two, Peru and Mexico, that are the new exotic novelties. And in Spain, we are not going to see a universalist claim, because the universal monarchy was an accusation by the enemies of the monarchy and not an official claim, more than the globes that could appear in the Gloria of Titian or in the Giordano's frescoes in El Escorial, or the plus ultra divis, are subtle elements, but there is, I have a good line of research here, that while the Pope had a vision of obedience of the world and the peoples of the world in a very ecumenic sense, the Spanish monarchy had a dynastic and jurisdictional view, and the world is not seen through nations or ambassadors, but real kingdoms with rights and a coat of arms that were direct properties of the King of Spain. Thank you very much.